When the railway first arrived, Hastings was still a relatively small fishing town. The station, originally named the Priory, was located on the western outskirts of the town, only the eastern side of the valley having been developed. In the 1830s, both the London and Brighton and South Eastern Railways had been interested in Hastings, and although the London and Brighton had reached Bulverhithe by 1846, it was not until 1851 that the SER finally opened its line from Bo Peep to Ashford. The railway opened up new markets for the fishermen, who were soon operating a more modern fleet, and it brought tourists in their thousands for holidays by the sea and to admire Hastings' historic past. The station is now in the centre of the town, which has grown to join up with what had been Burton's exclusive new town of St Leonard's. The present-day station building and part of the forecourt are located on what had been the terminus for LBSCR trains arriving from the west. The original LBSCR line curved off to the right through the area now covered by the post office building. The original station was V-shaped, with the point of the V towards the camera. LBSCR trains passed to the right of the V and SER to the left. The station was rebuilt in 1931 with island platforms. Platforms 3 and 4 now stand where the engine shed once stood. Brighton trains still use platform 2 on the old LBSCR side of the station, preserving a link with the past. The 1931 rebuilding left only the goods shed unaltered, but even that was later replaced by this structure, which was actually demolished during filming in early summer 1987. To the east of Hastings Station, the line crosses the soft reed beds of the Priory Valley, where a massive embankment had to be built. This was constructed using spoil from the tunnels. The embankment was originally pierced by a road tunnel known as St Andrew's Archway, where the bridge now crosses Queen's Road. This traffic bottleneck was replaced by the present bridge in 1898. The spoil from the tunnels was also used to change the geography of the station area. The station and roads seen here in the foreground are built on earth and rock removed from the tunnels. The line from Eastbourne was electrified in 1935. There was insufficient space to provide carriage sidings at Hastings, so the electrification was carried through to Orr, where a shed was built for electric multiple units. The old warehouses would once have been alive with activity, but now look rather forlorn. By 1987, the Hastings to Ashford line had become the regular haunt of most non-standard diesel electric multiple units, including the remaining Hastings units. Apart from those still in service on the Ashford line, a number of withdrawn Hastings units were still around in 1987 awaiting their last journey to the scrapyard. Ashford trains have used platform 1 for many years, consequently the western end of the platform was little used. In 1986 the track from that end was lifted to allow for the construction of a covered walkway, giving direct access to platforms 1 and 2 without the need to cross the footbridge. The remaining concreted area can be clearly seen as tadpole 206101 leaves for Ashford. From the station, the line passes under South Terrace Bridge, past the warehouses before crossing Queen's Road and entering Mount Pleasant Tunnel. The tunnel is 230 yards long, and the soft earth through which it passes gave its builders quite a few problems. In 1850, 30,000 cubic yards of earth that had been piled up on the embankment on the eastern side slipped down and twisted the tunnel mouth. The tunnel then had to be lengthened and a massive wall of bricks built to hold back the spoil. Our station was built in 1887 to serve the growing northeast area of Hastings. It opened on the 1st of January 1888. Behind our station, the 1935 emu shed still stood in 1987. It closed with the electrification of the Tunbridge line a year earlier, but was still being used to store withdrawn Hastings units. Before the shed was built, there had been a goods yard here complete with cattle pens and an additional siding leading off to Hastings and District Tramway's power station. The main power station stands just to the east, and the siding which once supplied it and the brickworks on the far side of the lane were still there in 1987, although very much overgrown from disuse. Now, only the hourly Ashford trains disturb the tranquillity of what would once have been a hive of activity. The gates now stand permanently closed, and nature is beginning to reclaim her own. It's a good many years since these rails saw the passing of wheels. The crossover for electric trains is near the siding, and the few electric trains still came through as far as or after the emu shed closed. Until the shed closed, a Victoria train crossed over here every hour on its way to the shed to be swept through. This is the 1643 to Brighton, the only train of the day that still starts its journey from Orr. Opposite the siding is the new crossover that was added to enable up trains to cross over to the old down line when the line was singled in 1979. The electrified head shunt continues right up to the mouth of Orr Tunnel. Orr Tunnel is 1,402 yards long, and it too presented problems to its builders. It passes through hard rocky ground that needed blasting. Difficulties were also encountered with a clay substance called clunch and with underground streams. The tunnel passes under the ridge with its industrial estates and emerges into a wooded cutting across a fruit farm. From here, the line runs alongside the Fairlight Hills before arriving at the first of the halts that opened in 1907 with the rail motor service. This rural area can't have changed much since the line opened in the middle of the last century. Three Oaks and Gastling Halt was originally named Three Oaks Bridge. The bridge referred to was only the road bridge by the halt. Bridge was soon dropped and Gastling Halt added. Three Oaks Village is just a scattered collection of houses, but it boasts a rather splendid hotel. The disused up platform was still there in 1987, but with a hole where the shelter once stood. The halt is now named simply Three Oaks. The next halt is named after a nearby farm. It was originally called Gastling, but as most of Gastling is nearer Three Oaks, the name was changed. Again, the halt has now been dropped. The last of the 1907 halts is at Snailham Farm. It opened as Snailham Crossing Halt and was mainly used by hop pickers and fishermen on their way to the River Brede. This halt closed in 1959, but the crossing is still used by farm workers, although the hops have been replaced by fruit. Where other country lanes have grown into roads, the lane to Snailham has been frozen in time. The modern, flat-bottomed, welded track contrasts starkly with sleepy, forgotten Snailham. From Snailham, the line crosses the Brede Levels and arrives in sheep country. The sheep, once a source of income for the railway, must outnumber people in this sparsely populated area. The line crosses the River Brede and more sheep farms before arriving in Winchelsea. This was the first station outside Hastings for the first 36 years after the line opened. Winchelsea Station Building is the first of several on the line designed by William Tress. This building is almost identical to the one at Ham Street. Both have this unusual three-sided canopy. Unlike Ham Street, this one is now a private dwelling, occupied by an art potter. The platforms are staggered, as was typical SER practice. It was considered safer for passengers to cross behind a departing train. Automatic open crossing has replaced the gates in Crossing Keeper's Cottage. Winchelsea, like most of the villages on the line, is not very near its station. The cyclist will have over half a mile to travel before reaching the village through one of its gateways. The original village was swept away in a storm in 1287. It was completely rebuilt on the nearby hump of high ground. It's changed little since it was built and has been described as a fossilised village. The sea has receded from Winchelsea and the railway runs below Cabra Cliff near to the old Saxon shoreway. From Winchelsea Station, Rye can be clearly seen on its island of land that was once amidst the sea. It's not hard to imagine the waves lapping beneath Cabra Cliff. This is the River Tillingham beside Rye's best-known landmark. It then crosses Ferry Road before arriving in Rye Station. The signal box dates from 1893. It now controls the coloured light signals on the tokenless block section, single line sections, Douar and Appledore. The station building is another example of Tress's Italianate architecture. The parcel shed was later added by the Southern Railway in similar style. Rye Station has another example of SER staggered platforms. The foot crossing was replaced by the present bridge in the early 1960s, when the line was included in phase two of the Kent electrification programme. On the eastern side of the station, the crossing keeper's cottage was still in use as a private dwelling in 1987, but would not be much longer if local opposition could not defeat a plan to build a bypass through the station. Unlike Winchelsea, Rye has spread and swallowed up its station, but old Rye is unchanged. It still looks like a harbour town, even though the sea has long since receded and left it high and dry. Rye has two unusual industrial relics. These are water cisterns. The first one in Wish Ward is complete with an ancient hand pump. To reach the second one, the visitor has to climb the cobbled street passing the world-famous Mermaid Inn. The inn was built in 1420 and was well known as a resort of smugglers and highwaymen. The second cistern stands in the yard behind the 12th century church. The church itself is well known for its quarterboys on the outside of the tower. This cistern, which dates from 1735, is at the side of a quiet cobbled street opposite the Ypres Tower. The tower, and gun garden beside it, were part of England's defences against Napoleon. From the gun gardens, a spectacular view can be had across Rye Harbour. The sea has receded so far that Rye Harbour, like Rye before it, has been left still not quite on the sea. Until 1960, it would have been possible to follow the smoke of steam trains making their way down to the railway pier, but now the only smoke to be seen comes from the chimney of the chemical works. A quick visit to Rye Harbour will reveal no trace of the branch line. There is no trace of where the line once crossed the Winchelsea Road. A house now stands on the spot, but around the corner on the other side of the sluice there is still plenty of evidence. A pillbox still guards a non-existent railway from a non-existent enemy, long after both have faded into history. The place where the bridge once stood is marked by pieces of old railway line holding up the bank. On the other side of the road, the line has become a footpath. Any doubts that we were filming in the right place disappeared when we passed the gate. Here we found proof in the form of two engineers' marker plates, still marking a stream that once passed under the track. Looking back towards the road, the path looks a bit more convincing. There are even a few old wooden sleepers pushed hard into the ground. The path ends at a new industrial estate. A siding once branched off near here. It passed through a chemical works where a few yards of track still existed in 1987, then crossed the road and went right down to the waterfront. The main part of the line crossed the road further down and continued through where this building now stands to end at the railway pier. Until 1939, there had been a 3-foot gauge tramway on the far side of the harbour. Its station building was still there nearly 50 years later. The Ryan Camber Tramway Company was formed in 1895, mainly to serve a new golf links on the outskirts of Camber and to transport fishing crews to and from boats left at Rye Harbour. The branch line ended here at a pier. Its exact location is again marked by pieces of railway line, originally placed there to hold up the bank. They now serve a useful purpose for mooring boats. The railway pier was quite close to the William the Conqueror Inn. This old SCR coach is still at Rye Harbour as a reminder that trains once came here. The branch line ran behind Winchelsea Road and joined the main Ashford line near the windmill. Rye is about halfway between Hastings and Ashford and is the place where the two DMUs working the service normally pass. The timetable normally works very well, and the waiting time is usually quite short. On the eastern side of Rye, the line crosses the River Rother. The present bridge replaced the original swing bridge in 1903. The new bridge was tested by 4 locomotives and tenders coupled together. One of them, number 736, was built in Ashford in 1901 and not withdrawn until 1950. The bridge still has a broken but well-preserved South Eastern and Chatham Railway sign, promising trespassers a fine not exceeding 40 shillings. The main coast road crosses the line in two places on the edge of Walland Marsh. Goldford Crossing is the first. The modern successors of the old freight trains now roar through the quiet country lanes alongside the railway. After Star Crossing, the second on the coast road, the line draws slowly away from Cabra Cliff and continues roughly parallel to the Royal Military Canal. On through the marshland mist, one more minor road has to be crossed before reaching Appledore. Just outside Appledore station, the Dungeness branch line trails off across Romney Marsh. The branch line is now very quiet. It closed to passenger traffic in 1967, and although the occasional gravel train still passes this way, the remaining section to Dungeness owes its existence mainly to the nuclear power station. The area is so flat that Ashford trains can still be seen from Snargate. In common with the other 13 crossings on the branch, Snargate once had a crossing keeper's cottage, but only a few tiles remain where it once stood. Very little traffic comes this way by rail or road, and passers-by could be forgiven for thinking that the line was closed. Especially with this amount of overgrowth. The crossings are of the completely open type, but the infrequent traffic makes them very safe. The hoped-for crowds of holidaymakers never arrived on this line, even after a diversion in 1937 took it nearer to the holiday camps. From King Street Crossing, the old station building at Brookland is visible through the trees, while it seems that someone has been using the quiet line as a rubbish tip. Brookland Station opened in 1881. It stands beside the main coast road and is just under a mile from both Brookland and Brenzett. It once had a signal box and passing loop, but became a halt as long ago as 1930. The loop was removed about 1950, the down platform becoming disused from the same time. After so many years as a private dwelling, the building is still unmistakably a railway station. The name of the station survives on the level crossing. This crossing between Brookland and Lydd has a name more descriptive of the area. The most important station on the branch was at Lydd. The inn on the left was originally called the Station Hotel. Over on the other side of the road, the station yard became a driving centre. The bridge, the only one on the branch, was not strong enough for the heavy construction traffic to and from Dungeness Power Station, so a slip road had to be built beside it with a level crossing. The station buildings found further use with the local tyre company. The slip road and level crossing were added in 1961. The landscape south of Lydd is bleak and featureless. The station steps must have witnessed the passing of many thousands of feet, especially in the days when the army used the station to serve their nearby camp. The suffix town was added when Southern Railways opened their new station at Lydon-Sea in 1937. There was a signal box here until the end of passenger traffic. Since then, the points have had to be hand-operated. There were once several sidings nearby, including one each for the waterworks and the British Quarry Company. A branch also led off to Lyd Military Camp. Following the road to Dungeness, we find the present-day end of the line opposite the power station. That mournful noise has nothing to do with the nuclear age. It's just a steam locomotive on the nearby Romney Hythe and Dymchurch Railway. The crane standing across the siding is used to load steel flasks containing spent nuclear fuel rods onto flatterel wagons. The flasks are then transported to Sellafield in Cumbria for reprocessing. The Dungeness branch ends by the crane, where a passing loop has been provided for shunting the flask trains. The main part of the line that once went on to New Romney now ends at the buffers nearby. The Dungeness branch originally continued along what is now the road to the power station. Movements of flasks from the power station usually take place about once a week, but the running times are classified, making it very difficult to film anything. Fortunately, Vic Mitchell was able to do the impossible and obtain pictures one freezing cold January morning. The train has brought back an empty flask to be exchanged for a full one. The full flask is first shunted out onto the remains of the New Romney branch. The empty flask is then placed under the crane using the runaround loop. On trains carrying hazardous loads, the guard has to travel remote from the driver, making a guard's van necessary. On this bitterly cold morning, the guard, quite understandably, didn't want to take the cold van that had been freezing on the siding since before Christmas. This made an extra shunt necessary to couple the warm van to the loaded train. Meanwhile, the empty flask has been loaded onto the lorry for return to the power station. The Dungeness branch used to end at a station near the lighthouse and Coast Guard station. The remains of the station were still evident amongst the shingle in 1987. The usual pieces of railway line remain sticking out of the ground, and old wooden sleepers have been used to make a path to this cottage. Opposite the site of the old Southern Railway station, the narrow gauge Romney Hythe and Dymchurch Railway is still very much alive. The miniature steam locomotive is delighting visitors of all ages. A band of admirers always seems to appear from nowhere as soon as a train arrives. A spectacular view of the turning loop can be had by anyone with the energy to climb to the top of the lighthouse. The nearby power station contrasts the nuclear age with the age of steam. Many old railway carriages from an earlier era remain at Dungeness as private dwellings. Now we can return across the bleak landscape to the land of sheep and Appledore station. This station is another example of William Tress architecture. Unusually, the later canopy was added onto the side of the goods shed. The building is unmistakably in Tress's Italianate style, and even boasts its original Victorian postbox. The crossing keeper's cottage has survived, again as a private dwelling. Opposite the station, the railway hotel has an unusual adornment in the middle of its garden. The goods shed is still serving a useful purpose, albeit not the one it was intended for. A modern signal box has been added opposite the crossing keeper's cottage. As can be seen, the single line section ends at Appledore. Dowell's Crossing, a solitary semaphore signal still stood in 1987. From here, the land starts to rise again towards Warehorne. Warehorne Churchyard provides an excellent view of the railway bridge across the Royal Military Canal. The canal was completed in 1806, but became redundant with Nelson's victory at Trafalgar. Sheep continued to be found everywhere, from the churchyard right down to the canal bank itself. This part of the canal is now controlled by the National Trust as an area of outstanding natural beauty and for its wildlife. The pillbox still defends the railway bridge from would-be invaders using the canal in reverse. Trees begin to reappear as the line continues to climb onto Weald and Clay. There are even orchards nearby that once provided extra income for the railway. After Warehorne Crossing, we reach Ham Street, the last station before Ashford. Another building by William Tress, and as mentioned earlier, almost identical to the one at Winchelsea, right down to the three-sided canopy. The staggered SER platforms and foot crossing are still in use at Ham Street. This is one of very few foot crossings left in southern England. From the station, the line climbs noticeably. The surrounding land has by now risen enough for an overbridge at Poundhurst Road. Mm-hmm. 3D unit 207009 is made up of 3D driving trailer and trailer composite with a Hastings motor brake, giving it a very different appearance at each end. The next level crossing at Rucking once had a public siding on the upside of the line. A further siding was laid from it during World War II to accommodate a super heavy gun. Similar sidings were also laid into Goldenwood to the north and Hollybush to the south. The last part of the line is fairly level, more than 100 feet above sea level. The quiet rural countryside around King's North is deceptive. Large towns and civilization seem to be miles away, but the suburbs of Ashford with its new housing estates creep ever nearer. Quite near to the line behind one of the estates, the Ashford Railway Museum is in preparation. The Hastings line crosses the road near to the old railway works that were established in 1847 by the SER to build locomotives. Production continued until 1962. After that, only wagons were produced until 1981, when the works were finally reduced to handling only components. On the other side of the line, the present-day works at Chart Leacon has its football ground. The modern appearance of Ashford Station contrasts with all of the others on the line. Ashford itself has changed a great deal since the railway arrived. It has been a market centre for sheep and cattle farmers of Romney Marsh and the Weald of Kent since the Middle Ages. It was natural for the town to develop into the busy and important railway junction that it is today. Apart from the coastal routes to Hastings and Folkestone, there are alternative routes to London via Canterbury or Maidstone. For L Unit 203001, has been painted back into Southern Region green livery to celebrate the 30th birthday of the Hastings Demus. This is the location of the original SER station. Until 1899, the London Chatham and Dover Railway had its own terminus further on. In an attempt to please all of its fans, 203001 will appear in both liveries on the journey back down to Hastings.